Good afternoon. We're going to start. I'd like to welcome you all. I'm Maxim Shrayer, and I direct the project on Russia and Russian and Eurasian Jewry here at the Davis Center at Harvard University. Our project is now in its second year, and it's generously underwritten by Genesis Philanthropy Group. We're very grateful for the support. We also have additional support from the Center for Jewish Studies here at Harvard, and of course from the Davis Center. And this event on Vasily Grossman is the second event in this year's series on great Russian Jews. Some of you were here last month for our event on Golda Meir, which featured Sam Casso and Nina Lachav. And all our events are available online. And if you can't make some of them, please take some time and enjoy watching them. I think they're well worth spending some time in front of the screen. And I also want to tell you that we'll have two more events in the spring. In April and in May, we'll have an event, because basically this year, we're trying something a little different. That is to say, we're broadening the scope beyond just literature, history, and culture. And in the spring, we'll be also exploring the contribution of the great Jewish Soviet chess player and teacher, mentor of other chess players, Mikhail Botvinnik. And we'll have Grandmaster Emil Sutovsky and also another very prominent chess player, John Donaldson, who is also Bobby Fischer's biographer. And the second event will be devoted to the virtuoso violinist, David Oistrakh, and we'll have one of his most prominent disciples, Oleg Krysa, and also Harla Robinson, which many of you know, who is an American historian of Russian and Soviet music and theater. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce the speakers, and we have a little under an hour for this conversation, then we'll take some questions. I'm very, very happy to welcome Alexandra Popoff and Boris Lanin. Alexandra Popoff, author and scholar, was, oh, by the way, allow me just to say one more thing, because the mission of Genesis is, of course, to promote Jewish Russian culture, history, identity. This panel is all Jewish Russian, although all the panelists here come from very different walks of life and different backgrounds, but I think we all share a passion for the contributions that Jews have made to Russian culture, Soviet culture, and world culture. So, sorry, Sasha, I just had to, because somehow it occurred to me that we rarely have such a lineup. Alexandra Popoff, author and scholar, was born in Moscow into a family of Russian Jews. Upon graduating from the Gorky Literary Institute in 1982, she worked as a writer and editor at the Literaturnaya Gazeta, Literary Gazette. In 1991, as an Alfred-friendly press fellow, she wrote for the Philadelphia Inquirer Sunday magazine. She holds two graduate degrees in literature from the University of Toronto and the University of Saskatchewan, where she has also taught. Some of you know Alexandra Popoff as a literary biographer, particularly as the author of the acclaimed biography, The Wives, Women Behind Russian Literary Giants, which I truly admire, and which deals, among other literary wives, with Sofia Bers, Sofia Tolstoy, and Vera Nabokov, Vera Slonim. And as Vasily Grossman's new biographer, Alexandra Popoff's new biography of Grossman is forthcoming from Yale University Press, and I'm very much looking forward to its publication. And Alexandra lives in Canada, has been living in Canada since 1992. Boris Lanin was born in Baku to a Jewish Russian family. The first thing I asked him when we met was, are you Mountain Jew or Ashkenaz? And of course he said, Ashkenaz. I was a little disappointed, but we moved on. And he is head of literature and professor at the Academy of Education of Russia, and one of Russia's leading authorities on teaching literature in middle and high school. He has served as a visiting professor at a number of distinguished institutions, such as the Kennan Institute, the Woodrow Wilson Center, the Institute for Advanced Studies in Paris, and also more recently the Alfred Krupp Wissenschaftskolleg. Professor Lanin's textbooks of literature are widely used at secondary schools in the Russian Federation, and the last I checked, something like 1 million copies of them have been sold, which is incredible. And he was instrumental in infusing Jewish Russian writers into the school curriculum. In Russia, he is a leading specialist in Vasily Grossman, is on the board of the Grossman Center in Turin, and is currently spending a semester as a National Endowment for Humanities Distinguished Visiting Professor at State University of New York at Potsdam, which is up near the Canadian border in upstate New York. And most recently, he has published a study of the third wave prose of the Russian immigration. And one other interesting fact, going back to what I said about Batvinnik, Boris is also an accomplished chess player and has written a textbook of chess for children, which is about to be published. So welcome, Sasha. So Sasha, I think you now need to write some book that does not deal with literature, but I don't know, some other, you know, some other sort of esoteric topic. Yes, so with that in mind, today we are exploring the rich legacy of Vasily Grossman, author, journalist, Shoah witness, political philosopher in his later years. And I'd like to begin by asking both of you, Alexandra and Boris, well, what is Grossman best remembered for today?
Best remembered probably for comparing Bolshevism and Nazism. And this is precisely what Hannah Arendt has done in 1951. So two scholars, and Grossman was a writer and scholar, I believe, two great writers, independently from each other, were working on the same topic. Why? Well, because both experienced the Holocaust, and both had to explain what happened to themselves and to the world. It's time to think clearly. It's time to think clearly, wrote Grossman in Everything Flows, his last novel. It's time to understand and to explain things. So Grossman's Life and Fate, his famous novel, raises issues of state nationalism, anti-Semitism, tells about the Holocaust, the Gulag, the Second World War. It illustrates the greatest events, the greatest tragedies of the 20th century. And moreover, his themes sound contemporary today, because today we think and write about nationalism, the rise of nationalism in the world, the rise of anti-Semitism, and we live in dread of another world war. So none of these topics actually something that is in the past, but is something that we continue to think about.
Boris, let me ask you this. I very much agree.
I would like to add two phrases.
Exactly.
In nowadays Russia, comparing Nazism and Stalinism is a federal crime. So he escaped again.
So he would have been tried? He might have.
He might have. And Grossman now is a classical writer in full sense of that word, because in Russian tradition, classical writers are those who are studied at secondary schools, and now he is part of school curricula.
What exactly is in the curriculum?
Just fragments from Life and Fate.
Okay.
And now I work on special supplements for each grade for the curricula for the migrants, because Russia is the second largest world country with 12 million of migrants.
So there are separate textbooks.
And for them, probably there will be his Armenian essay as well.
Interesting.
But perhaps the fragments from Life and Fate would deal with the Second World War rather than with Holocaust.
Oh no. I added the fragments with the camp, with the Holocaust, and all the necessary parts that are missing in that 12 episodes film.
That's great.
But is it on the selective, or is this on the selective list?
Of course it is selective. Yes, it is very personal.
Just secondary,
yes.
Secondary school.
I struggled for 15 years for that. It is very selective and very personal.
Right, and we will, of course, return to Life and Fate in a little while, but I'd like to go back to Grossman's beginnings for a little bit and just remember that, of course, he comes from a very important part of the former Pale, right? Berdichev had 80% Jewish population before the revolution, and even in 1926, 56%. So clearly Jews did not feel a minority. I say this, of course, in contrast to some other very famous Jewish Russian writers of Grossman's generation, right? He grew up very much in a major center of Jewish life, and as you know, Berdichev was often called the Jerusalem of Valin. So, Sasha, I'd like you to tell us a little bit about his family, about his background, because it was unusual, especially considering the very predominantly Jewish surroundings.
Yes, it was. He grew up in assimilated secular in a family of secular Jews. It was an assimilated family, and in Berdichev, which belonged to the Kiev province, only 3% of Jews would name Russian as their mother tongue. So. His family was a minority. His father was not from Berdichev. His mother, actually, was also not from Berdichev originally. Her family came from Lithuania and settled in Odessa, in a big city. And this was an assimilated family. This was a wealthy family. On both his mother and his father's side, Grossman families were wealthy. Merchant families. His father, Solomon, or he would call himself in the Russian fashion, Semyon Osipovich, or Solomon Osipovich Grossman, was born in a city, in a town of Reni. This was on the border with Romania, Bessarabia. On the border of Romania, currently a territory of Ukraine. So his father had to break with his milieu because his father was born in a shtetl. And his father belonged to this revolutionary generation.
He was a member of the Bund, right?
Not quite. He was a Menshevik. He was a member of a revolutionary party. The reason Jews were drawn to revolutionary parties is that revolutionary parties promised racial and social equality. And Jews in the Russian Empire were the most persecuted among the minorities. Really wanted to escape the Pale, where they were assigned to live.
Yeah, so just to interrupt you, Boris, what's your sense in terms of Vasily Grossman's beginnings as a Jewish Russian writer, of initially the Jewishness of his youth and the Jewishness of his earliest works? So just moving ahead, so he is educated as an engineer, you know, he has his literary debut in Moscow in 1934 with the story in the town of Berdichev. Talk about that.
You know, wonderful Abkhazian writer Fazil Iskander wrote his epic novel, Sandro from Chegem, And over there, there is only one Jewish character, some Solomon, who comes to mountain area to exchange salt and needles for the fruits. And for the Abkhazians, he is kind of alien. And they ask him, how people become Jews? Are they told by somebody that they are Jews, or they are already born being Jews? So I think that he was born Jews, and he didn't need any remindings.
So,
and he was, you know, a Jew, but all his ever, all his every novel was written from the position of minority. This is, if we have a look at all his writings at once, kind of gestalt, we get a sense that this is the encyclopedia of the Soviet man written from the position of minorities.
Yes, Alexandra.
I would say that Grossman would probably speak of himself as a Russian writer and a Jew, just like Rimbaud. Indeed, his some of his earliest works, his article he published in 1929, Berdichev, not as a joke but seriously, dealt with Jewish theme. This was even before his literary debut. He wanted to say that anti-Semitism, in this article he implied, suggested very, that anti-Semitism belonged to the past, belonged to the pre-revolutionary days. Let us treat Berdichev and people who live there as equals. Yes, he did speak from a position of minority, and he was always, he always wanted equality, equal rights. Social.
That's quite natural for all the minorities.
By the way, we should probably pause and explain how he got his literary pseudonym, his pen name, because of course he was born Iosif Grossman.
How
he becomes Vasily, and how he decides to sign his name. Well, because it's an unusual, in other words, what I mean is,
yes,
the more conventional, of course, path would be to Russianize the last name, right? Say, David Kaufman becomes David Samoylov. He becomes Vasily Grossman, which obviously does not delete the Jewishness, but it kind of dilutes it a bit.
Grossman's daughter, Katya Grossman, Karatkova Grossman, told me that Grossman's mother liked the name Vasya, Vasily, and called her son Vasya. Grossman's mother, her name at birth was Malka. Malka, she did not use this name. She preferred to use the Russian name Yekaterina, Yekaterina Savelyevna. And she called her son Vasya, and he signed his articles and works Vas Grossman. So that was not quite a pseudonym, but that was his nickname in childhood.
Very good. But so let's spend a little time talking about Grossman, in a way, I think, before he becomes Grossman. That is to say, the Grossman of the 1930s, before the Nazi invasion and before the start of the Shoah. So, Boris, talk to us about his first two novels, Glück auf and Stepan Kaltschugin, and what's your sense of where they fit?
I think that Grossman never became Grossman while he was alive. He became Grossman only after his death. And we learned about him only after his death. His life was struggling with his fate all the time. And his first novels are really mediocre, gray Soviet novels without any blink of any talent or whatever. And it is absolutely nothing.
Well, that's what we're here for.
It is absolutely nothing
to disagree,
to find out over there. You know, there was, you know, some people need to be awakened. You know, that was Holocaust for him.
Okay.
Before that, especially Stepan Kaltschugin,
which Stalin called a Menshevik novel.
Oh, yeah.
Right? True or not?
He could call it anyway, but it
wasn't. It was a bestseller in Soviet times, and rightly so. I read numerous letters written by readers to Grossman that, unlike so many In so many Soviet works, his characters were not cardboard, but they were living people. The main thing about Grossman, even his early works, and Grossman became Grossman in 1934 with his novella In the Town of Berdichev. It was unlike anything written about the Civil War, unlike anything, because it was not actually about the Civil War. It was not about the war between the Reds and the Whites. It was about human beings. The story was written with great empathy. It was centered on individual lives. A woman commissar is giving birth in Berdichev. She was someone who led her platoon in a battle, for whom human life simply, people did not matter. She would kill. And here she becomes pregnant. A woman commissar becoming a loving mother, and the birth of that child. And it was written with such empathy. And then he takes a contemporary cliche, a sacrifice for the revolution, which she does. She abandons her 10-day-old child to a Jewish family with whom she is staying, and she goes to fight for the revolution, and she, of course, will die. But how he turned that contemporary cliche into something very meaningful, because it was unheard of that a mother would abandon her child. And so, immediately after the story was published, Mikhail Bulgakov, Babel, and Gorky, all major writers, and Boris Pilniak, said that it was a new writer. The story was immediately translated into German. It was a new word. Now, with Glukhov, it was not a great novel.
Which is about miners.
It was about miners. Grossman worked for 2 years in the hottest and most dangerous mine in the Donbass as a chemical engineer. And he described conditions that were very much like during industrial revolution in England. He wrote the truth. And this truth was not passed in 1932. He was endlessly edited, and still, after many edits, his novel was called counter-revolutionary, to contain counter-revolutionary tendencies, and was huge accusation.
Right, but so in other words, Sasha, just to understand, you know, your view is that the 1930s works by Grossman, I already major sort of
yes,
presences
he,
on
he
the
had
Soviet
to rewrite
horizon.
This novel, and then what came out in 1934 was bleak.
Okay.
But he had to rewrite.
But is.
Well, I also like Grossman, you know, you shouldn't
By the way, just so you know, Boris Lanin coined a phrase that I think every Grossman scholar quotes, which is, correct me if I'm not quoting, that Grossman rehabilitated the concept of freedom, right?
That's true.
For
That's
the Soviet
true.
Union.
Yeah.
So, in other words, he's certainly very partisan when it comes to
but,
Grossman.
You know, I had 2 months in my life when I worked in Japan, and I got a visitor, you know, every day. That was Dmitry Alexandrovich Prigov, who used to visit my office because he had no internet there. So he used to come to check his email. And he always asked me, what is the language of this or that writer?
Mm-hmm.
I think that early Grossman didn't have any sense of
style
at all. Even if we take that famous film, The Commissar, by Alexandra Skoldov, please note that the characters exchange the dialogues from Babel, and he just borrowed those dialogues because Grossman's dialogues were very weak.
Yeah. Boris is referring, by the way, to the very famous film by Alexandra Skoldov, his only film, which was shelved which we made in 1967 and shelved, which was based on the story of which Alexandra just spoke so passionately in the town of Berdichev.
And if we are scholar, we should, if we are the scholars, we should, you know, try to keep an objective view. And the objective view says that he had no sense of style, at least before the World War II. He was typical Soviet writer who was very understandable to the reading masses. That's why they praised him, because they could understand.
Might I just add one thing? I think perhaps even if we agree to disagree here on the value of the two novels, I think two things strike me as unusual. One is the sheer number of Jewish characters, minor and major. And two, I think that in the early works, and two, that Grossman has, up until about 1943.
Yeah, I never saw so many Jewish minors after that.
The view that Soviet Jews are beholden to the revolution, and I think he never questions that. And I think in the 1930s, there are other opinions, even among Soviet Jews. But let's fast forward. I want to get to, by the way, Alexandra, do tell us, because you gave us some wonderful pictures. What is Grossman doing in March of 1941 in Estonia with Alexander Twardovsky, of all people?
Yes, well, we have to go to Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact of 1939 and the secret protocol that assigned greater influence to the Soviets in the Baltics. And apparently Grossman and Twardovsky were sent to Estonia to write what they have written. What Grossman has written, I could never trace.
Very interesting. I also didn't know.
I knew, and I spoke with his stepson, who still holds on to a portion of the archive and would not release it. We spoke about Grossman writing about it, and then I tried to press him with further questions, but when Mr. Gruber doesn't want to talk, he doesn't talk. So, and the available information in the archives, I simply could not trace what was published. But I know that before the war, they worked together.
So let's turn to the early months of the catastrophic months of the Nazi invasion and talk about Grossman's journalism. He becomes a staff writer for Krasnaya Zvezda, the Red Star, the principal organ of the Red Army. And let's talk about the summer and fall 1941, when he really becomes a major voice of Soviet frontline journalism.
Grossman approached Krasnaya Zvezda editor Ertenberg in the beginning of the war, and on August 6th, he and a number of staff writer and the photographer Knoring left for the front. First months of the war were completely chaotic, disastrous because of Soviet unpreparedness for war. And because Stalin, because of a pact with Germany, refused to release any information, was afraid to provoke Hitler, and until the final moment, our troops on the border were unprepared, and the local population, mostly Jewish population, you saw the map with the pale, yes, all of these regions where majority of the Jews lived, and by the beginning of the war, 5 million Jews lived in the Soviet Union. So Stalin exposed to danger all of these people, and by not releasing any information about, almost no information about Nazis' atrocities against Jews, since 1939, newspapers were not supposed to write anything negative about Nazi Germany.
So what does Grossman write about in the early months of the war?
In the early months of the war, he was supposed to write about heroic defense of certain cities and towns which fell without any
resistance.
Because in the first 10 days, the Nazis advanced 350 miles into the Soviet territory. This advance was uncontainable from the Baltic to the Black Sea, precisely the same territories that were occupied before by Pale of Settlement.
So there is not a lot of material for heroics, and yet, Boris, out of these first disastrous months, Grossman manages to write a novel, Narod Besmert, and the people are or is immortal, which becomes tremendously successful. And in my crummy opinion, it still reads breathlessly.
Right, absolutely. Well, at that time, we had three really remarkable war writers, Simonov, Grossman, and Ehrenburg. And certainly, he was certainly the best because he managed to jump over the regular style and regular stamps of journalism of wartime and came to that novel. And that was about death and immortality.
There's actually one
instance. So it wasn't about victory. It wasn't about, you know, great hopes. It was about survival.
One of the smaller ironies, as you both know, is that Grossman actually makes a small error because he buries alive major war hero, the future marshal of armored forces, Babajanyan, who at the time was major and then colonel, whom he presumed to be dead. But heroized. It's the same man who would, in 1956, also suppress the Hungarian uprising, which is one of the smaller ironies of Grossman's life. That is part of the story. So in other words, he manages...
Probably at that time, he regretted that he lives that long.
I don't know.
Okay, because he was a war hero, you know.
Absolutely.
And then he became just a gendarme of Hungary.
In the novel, The People Immortal, Grossman anticipates the Nuremberg trials. So that is the most, this is probably the most important point. In the first months of the war, what he does, he takes notes. His wartime notebooks became invaluable material then later for creating all of his novels, including Life and Fate, and the first part of Life and Fate, and The People Immortal. This novel also is based on his notebooks, like he witnesses the bombing and burning of Belarusian city of Gomel, and that is one of the chapters in The People Immortal. And he anticipates the time when the great nations will come together and will denounce fascism. So it is an anticipation of the Nuremberg trials.
That's great. We should probably get to Stalingrad because, of course, it's at Stalingrad that I think Grossman gains the kind of national acclaim, right, becomes one of the principal voices of the people. And this is one of the photos that will be in your book, right, Alexandra? There are others of Grossman and Stalingrad. I want to ask you, of course, he writes a series of very famous reports, The Direction of the Main Strike, Through Chekhov's Eyes, but at the peak of the Battle of Stalingrad, he is actually recalled and he's moved. And what can you tell us about that? In other words, he does not report on the more victorious part.
Grossman remained in Stalingrad during the most dangerous times since August till December 1942. His last article was the end of December when the battle was still on, and he goes to the West Bank. That's where the battle is taking place. There were a few reporters who dared to go there, and he believed that he had no moral right to write about the defenders of Stalingrad if he did not go to the West Bank. So at the end of December, he takes a leave, and his editor, Artenberg, uses that as a pretext for replacing him with Konstantin Simonov, who would report on the victory. And Konstantin Simonov was, at that time, a young and talented poet and a journalist and a Stalin's favorite. So it was beneficial for the newspaper that Simonov and not the Jewish writer would report on the victory. By the end of a Stalingrad battle, which was a turning point of a Second World War, Stalin stopped playing the Jewish card. It was important for him to appeal to, to create the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee in 1942, and to have the Jews to appeal to brother Jews around the world, still in 1942, in 1943. But when the Stalingrad battle is won, Stalin no longer needs Jewish writers, and no longer the Jewish theme has to be reported.
You're absolutely correct. In fact, we can speak with some certainty about the period between Stalingrad and Kursk as the one when the unwritten policies are really increasingly practiced across the board, twofold, of course, and we'll talk about this momentarily, the non-reporting or obfuscating the specific Jewish losses and victimhood, but also Jewish battlefield valor. And Grossman's record is incredible on both counts. But I just want to, Boris, ask you, Stalin seemed to be, from the very beginning, not a great fan of Grossman. It seems that even going back to the 1930s, and again, you know, he's nominated for the Stalin Prize, he's passed over, Ehrenburg gets it for the fall of Paris, and there's something of a pattern. Do you make much of that?
Well, you know, we all know if you don't like somebody, you shouldn't marry, but at the same time, you shouldn't kill. So Stalin let him live, you know, but he didn't like him. He simply didn't like him. What can we do with that? That is the story of those two men.
I think one.
And if we compare him to Simonov, you know, in educational journals, you can find quiz, who is seven times Stalin's Prize winner. That was only one writer, that was Simonov. And Grossman never got that. And Stalin just crossed his name several years in a row. Right.
This was a prize established in Stalin's name. Stalin regarded that as his prize that he would give to a writer he would choose, to the writer of his choice. So he gave it to Ehrenburg for The Fall of Paris. He was interested in this novel and himself phoned Ehrenburg and talked about this novel. So he gave the prize in 1942 to Ehrenburg rather than to Grossman.
Yeah, but in a sense, as we're moving in the direction of how Grossman becomes a major witness to the Shoah in the occupied territories, one of the strangest parts of his experience at Stalingrad, I think, is that after being removed from Stalingrad, he goes to Kalmykia, where, oddly, he comes across the fairly recent aftermath of the Shoah, a small Jewish population which is executed there, and Grossman records it in his notebooks. I think that's the first time he actually...
Not the first, 1942. 1941, 1942 newspapers reported.
No, I'm talking about his first, in other words,
personal,
what he sees,
yes,
what he
yes,
sees.
Yes.
Because, of course, after that, the Soviet army goes on a mass offensive. This is Grossman at Kursk. And then in the summer of 1943, we really come to the point where Grossman begins to travel embedded with the troops, as we would call it today, as Ukraine and southern Russia is being liberated. And there he comes, of course, across massive, overwhelming evidence. So I think this might be a good point to talk about the works Before Life and Fate, in which he writes about the Shoah and about specifically the Shoah by bullet in the occupied territories. Shall we start with the old teacher?
With old teacher, yeah. Probably.
Okay, so by
well, that is at the beginning of real Grossman.
Okay.
But at the same time, you know, I have, you know, ambivalent feeling towards that story. This is just the beginning.
It's published, by the way, in 1943. It's one of the earliest fictional accounts published in the Soviet press of the Shoah in the occupied territories, but also of the collaboration of local populations with the Nazis. So it's pretty important, right?
You know, he raised several children, but my feeling is that he never understood children. He never understood kids. His kids are just little adults. And when 6 years old girl, you know, closes old teacher's eyes,
says, "Don't look,"
just to protect him from that terrible scene where people are dying, are killed. She protects him from the sight of mass killing. This is certainly not the kid. This is just small adult. But this is really very touching scene, and that is the beginning of Grossman. Certainly, several years ago, at the time when he worked at Life and Fate, he would stop here.
Later.
Yes, but being a Soviet writer whom he was, he immediately shows 140 workers who became partisans, who are coming to liberate whom? The graves? That is very strange. So he should stop right here after that terrible, you know, really heartbreaking scene. But he starts, you know, speculating on some, you know, workers who are being led by chief engineer.
Well, look, but
at the same time,
this changes.
You know, this it really affects the quality of writing.
Don't you think that that was the price he had to pay?
No,
that was the rhetoric.
No, it was wartime. The censorship was occupied by quite other topics and themes. Mm-hmm. They were looking at the, you know, war secrets and so on and so on.
Alexander.
That is his writer's level at that time, you know.
Boris, I want to just remind you that the children of that time were very different from our kids. They did not have time to grow up and mature. They haven't been given that time. And the girl, at the age of 5 or 6, she's a little wise woman. And the same with the boy, David.
Yeah.
Who is led in Treblinka, to Treblinka's, through the death march, through the path of no return. He has no time to grow up. His childhood is his adulthood. So that's what Grossman was trying to say, it seems. Now, we were talking about Kalmykia, where Grossman first encountered the Holocaust, Shoah by bullets. There were 93 families, Grossman was told, that were executed, 300 people. All of the Jews that remained under the occupation, everyone was killed. Every child, every adult, and every old person, everyone. And Grossman interviewed the local population to find out precisely how this was carried out, what was happening. And after that, he traveled through eastern Ukraine and through places where he worked as a mining engineer, the Donbass, Lugansk, all of these places, learning that where, say, in every town there were 11,000 Jews remaining under the occupation, everyone was killed. And during that trip, he had dreams of his mother. His mother remained in Berdichev. which was occupied on July 7th. The evacuation from Berdichev was not organized. People were escaping on foot. His mother was disabled since childhood. She had misalignment of hip joint, and Grossman was wiring money to her to allow her escape. She could not escape. There was no possibility. So he had dreams of his mother while traveling through the occupied territories. He realized that she was not alive. And that was the most horrible thing that happened in his life, and it weighed on his conscience. But he really could do nothing. If his mother was lucky enough to come and visit Grossman as he wanted before the war, then she would stay alive.
So, of course, I'm glad you mentioned this, because we have this wonderful slide of the house where she was living in Berdichev at the time of the occupation. Of course, before he comes to Berdichev and was able to confirm, right, his mother's death as part of about 20,000 Jews that were murdered there, he had already written a seminal essay, of which I know you write, and Boris, I think you've written about it too, Ukraine Without Jews, which is only published in Yiddish, and which begins famously with the words, "There are no Jews in Ukraine," meaning left in Ukraine, right? But he writes that even before he is able to confirm his mother's death.
Grossman had a rare ability to write about the death of millions, and that's what happened in the 20th century, something that a human mind cannot fathom, the death of millions. He was able to write about it in a personal way. So how he did that? By visualizing every, writing about these people as, old people. He can see them with, cataracts. Then he names them by profession. He's trying to bring these personal portraits of people so that they would remain in our collective memory. So that is why his article, Ukraine Without Jews, as well as his article about Treblinka, the Hell of Treblinka, can be read today with probably the same emotion as it would be read in the 1940s. But Ukraine Without Jews was unpublished.
It was published in Yiddish, in Yiddish, but not in Russian. Yeah.
Yes, unpublished in Russian. I saw the original copy in the archives, but was suppressed for a very long time because anti-Semitism remained an official Soviet policy still in the 1970s, in the 1980s, not under Gorbachev, but right until Glasnost.
Right. Well, let us fast forward a little bit because I think we must say something about the Hell of Treblinka and also then about the story of life and fate. But just very briefly, that Grossman travels with the Soviet troops. He is with the Soviet troops when Majdanek is liberated, which is the first major killing center, although he's not assigned the lead story, as you well know, which is, again, something of a pattern. The Soviet journalists who write the main stories about Majdanek, Simonov for Red Star, and Boris Garbatov for Pravda. So, in a sense, Grossman's time of glory as a chronicler of the Shoah comes with right reporting on Treblinka. And I think let's spend a little time speaking about the Hell of Treblinka. And Boris, like to know what your sense of this is as a literary document and as a work of journalism.
Yes, well, I would say that Grossman found right note writing about Holocaust, because the numbers don't work. You can, you know, count millions, it doesn't work. I remember my feeling when I was in Krakow and I saw a table in one house that 19 relatives were killed here, you know, from 2 years old to 89, And I realized that when I lived in Baku, we had only 8 relatives. And I liked some of them and disliked one person. But they were killed not because of the attitude towards them, but because they were Jews, and you cannot change it. And he found that he should go from a very personal way of life. You want to go to doctors, and doctors are killed. You want to study, and the teachers are missing, they are killed. And all of them are killed. So killing the Jews changes the life of the whole world. So from minor everyday people, everyday profession, he goes to global conclusion, but the conclusions are up to the readers. Yeah. And that is really, you know, the birth time of great Russian Jewish writer.
Sure. I just want to point out that this is one of the photos that actually reflects quite well what Grossman reports on, specifically in where he describes the earth that is revealing various objects, not just bones.
The earth that swallowed more lives than all of the earth's oceans, as he writes, the earth of Treblinka. He writes about it from different perspectives. First of all, Grossman was a scientist. He was educated as a scholar, so he had a mind of a scholar. He could present the event objectively, and that's what he does, dispassionately and objectively in Treblinka, because he interviewed the survivors who were hiding in the woods after Treblinka's uprising. He interviewed the local population. He was present during the interviews conducted, interrogations of some of the Nazis and some of the Ukrainians who guarded the camp. So he had all these different perspectives. And he walked from the station through the path of no return. Treblinka, when he came, there was nothing in it. He had to imagine it all. But he did see Majdanek. And that was the place where the Nazis did not have a time to destroy the evidence. And that's where he came, and for the first time he saw what happened, and he said that humanity has crossed the final line. I know this because he was with writer Delmatovsky, who later wrote a memoir about Grossman, and he quotes that humanity has crossed the final line. We'll never see anything worse than this. And after that he comes to Treblinka. He thought that Treblinka was the main death camp where some 3 million Jews were.
He made some miscalculations.
Well, he was an early chronicler of the Holocaust. These calculations were based on the facility, information given by the locals and some other calculations. But then from his perspective as a scholar, he goes to all human perspective, and he creates a very moving monument to the victims. It's very poetic and very moving at the very end. It's like it's a requiem to the victims.
Yeah, no, I very much agree, and I just want to, you know this well, but of course, Treblinsky, The Hell of Treblinka, is also something of a bestseller in 1945, and I was just looking at this edition. It's signed into print on March 1st, 1945, which is, of course, several months before the victory, and it's already becoming widely available to the Soviet population.
And he didn't know the difference between, regular camp and death factory, because
absolutely,
when somebody entered, when somebody crossed the gates of the death factory, only 50 minutes remained.
Well, he didn't have a sense of that.
He didn't know all the information about that.
Well, he didn't have a sense of the Aktion Reinhardt camps. I think he didn't have a sense that Treblinka, Sobibor, and Belzec were in a special group. Also, this is just a very nice illustration. This is the Yiddish edition, which comes out soon after the Russian. Because we only have a little time left, why don't we fast forward? And I think the story of Grossman's troubles and the arrest of life and fate is well told and well known, but I think I'd like us to spend some time talking about his post-mortem fame and acclaim, and also, Boris, you've written extensively about Grossman, not just as a writer of fiction, but as a political thinker.
Yeah.
Perhaps you could speak about that. Meantime, I'll find a couple of slides to go along.
Well, I wrote a small book, which is called Grossman and the Open Society. So he predicted many things that later appeared in Karl Popper's book on open society, that sense of opening the closed society was very special for a person who was born, raised, and lived under the totalitarian state. That really came from heaven. So that was amazing. But at the same time, what I'm interested in, really, who delivered the film with the manuscript abroad, because I interviewed several people, and at least two of them said that they did it by themselves, their own hands.
Well, I think
one was Vladimir Voinovich,
will enlighten us.
One was Vladimir Voinovich, who told me several times, and he told me about the camera he used and where he did it at Sakharov's apartment. I mean, Andrei Sakharov's apartment in Moscow, and so on and so on. And when I was talking about that in Woodrow Wilson Center, the Washington Post correspondent in Moscow, Sam Kaiser, he said, well, that was me, I did it. I did it with my American camera, and I used my channel in American embassy. So he used his channel in American embassy to send a manuscript to the Swiss publishing house
Ljaz Dom, which was actually
publishing
run by
house, which
a
is
Serbian man
really,
in Switzerland. But really, Alexandra, what's the real story?
Difficult.
Well, the real story was, I don't know, the story that we know is that when Grossman was dying, yes, I should probably mention that Grossman did not want to follow in Pasternak's footsteps and pass his novel abroad to be published. And that was probably the only possibility how his novel could come out even during Khrushchev's thaw. It was unthinkable. The comparison that goes through the whole novel between communism and Nazism, it was unthinkable to publish in 1961. Grossman wrote this novel for the Russian audience, for Soviet audiences, because they had to wake up and realize what they lived through. And he wanted the novel to appear. He knew that it was impossible. He didn't have any good, there were no choices for him. None of the choice was a good choice. So he sent the novel to Znamen magazine, a reactionary or a conservative magazine, where the editor of the magazine betrayed him. Now, why he chose conservative magazine?
Sorry,
because
he was invited to send.
Well, he published, first of all, much of his work in this Znamen magazine.
Because his principal wartime works were published there, including
yes,
the Hell of Treblinka.
Exactly.
I think that's why
yes.
he had a record with them.
Yes, and besides, he believed that a conservative editor would have a better choice and would be allowed to do more than the liberal editor like Twardovsky. So he sent his novel to Znamen magazine. Kazhevnikov, the editor-in-chief of Znamen magazine, betrayed him, sent the manuscript to the KGB. Grossman's fate was decided on the top level by the head of the KGB, Shalepin, who wrote a letter to Khrushchev. Then he wrote, we know that from Grossman's secret file, then he wrote the letter to the Central Committee. His letters were to inform Khrushchev and then the Central Committee that Grossman has written an anti-Soviet work. Then we know about the confiscation of life and faith. And then in the 1970s, yes, when Grossman was dying, he asked his friend Simon Lipkin, and he said to a few other people that I want my novel to be published at least abroad. Mm-hmm. And this is when Lipkin kept his word in the 1970s. He met Voynovich, Vladimir Voynovich, satirical writer, and said, I have a manuscript. And Voynovich said, Grossman, because he was expecting that. Everyone was hoping that one, at least one copy survived, and everyone knew that they were close friends.
Especially from Lipkin, right, Grossman. Exactly.
Yes, so, and then began, okay, we're out of time, really. Then began the photographing and attempts to smuggle abroad in microfilm, and then the triumph.
Right, I just want to say, we will have a little time for questions, but what is, I think, so remarkable about Grossman is, Edinburgh once said about him that he was born under an unlucky star. But of course, the post-mortem story very much contradicts that. That, you know, he's probably one of the three most famous and most read and taught writers who wrote in the Russian language today. And in that sense, it's a very, very happy story. I want to thank you both. Please stay here, don't go away. We will have some time for questions. So please, if you have questions, raise your hands and we will entertain them. Now. Yes.
There is a question.
I think there is a mic.
I wasn't going to be the first person, but my first question, the book wasn't published first in Yiddish. Did Vasily Grossman, The Hell of Treblinka, was it translated from Russian to English? I'm just curious if he knew Yiddish. And then my second thing is, I've just always been so curious about the fate. How is it that Grossman wasn't killed off? There must be so many, and Ehrenberg. I just don't understand. And does it have anything to do with them not being quote unquote Yiddish writers?
They were not.
And more Soviet writers.
Yes.
Well, The Hell of Treblinka was published in Znamen magazine in 1944 in the Russian language. Then Maxim was talking about separate editions. This article was distributed during the, became part of the evidence at the Nuremberg trials. Grossman and Edinburgh were not arrested. They were considered. They were on the list during the what is known as the black decade of Soviet Jewry, especially 1953 when doctor's plot this is the final campaign against Jews that Stalin launched. Grossman and Edinburgh were on the list to be arrested. So what happened? Stalin died, thankfully, on March 5th.
Good, thank you. More questions, please, comments.
You want to say anything about the collective letter that Jewish cultural figures were asked to sign in January, February 1953?
Yeah. There were two letters, actually. the first letter he didn't sign. And he was pressed by many other. Two famous people didn't sign the first letter. The first letter, the Berenburg and Grossman, they didn't sign it. The first draft was very cruel, actually. But later, the second draft was distributed. And the second draft he did sign. He was told that this is the only way, you know, to survive as a writer, and he trusted those people who told them. And so he signed the second draft, but both letters never were published, they never appeared.
And they never appeared
but
because...
But they never appeared because Stalin died.
There was a lot of pressure to sign these letters. There was a list of 57 famous Jews. They were pressed, their signatures were sought, they were threatened. Ehrenburg was someone who resisted till the last minute, who wrote a personal letter to Stalin explaining why this letter should not be published. However, he added, if you insist, of course, I would sign a letter. If you think this is in the interest of the Soviet state, I would sign. Then a softer version was produced, which Ehrenburg signed. And he said that people thought of me as someone who could approach Stalin and speak to him, and he would listen. In the reality, I was the same cog and screw like everyone else, and it was not me, but fate that decided the outcome.
And well, one small thing, that the rumors were about brand new camps that are already built in Siberia. Some people claim that they saw it. The most prominent, probably, the most prominent historian of Russian Jewry, some Gennady Kostyrchenko, said that he never saw any materials, including camps, about that.
Well, that is also the conclusion of Joshua Rubinstein in his recent book on Stalin's last months.
One of Yeltsin's aide, Mikhail Poltoranin, he said that he knew about that, he saw the documents, and the camps were built not in Siberia, but on Novaya Zemlya Archipelago.
That's a million-dollar question. I think, Joshua, you've dealt with it extensively, so thank you. Perhaps we'll take...
One more question.
Yes.
Probably last.
Please.
Well, why didn't you mention
Все течет? Well, we actually did not mention it, but we projected it.
Because it is, we didn't mention it because it is still flowing forever.
Yes. Last question, please.
Very easy. In one phrase, it was a repentance, and it contained, a request to save Jews from the people's anger, and that's why 57 Jews were supposed to ask to send them all to those camps just to survive and so on. Joshua,
you're going to have the last word in this.
Yes. I interviewed Daniel Kavieri and Margarita Ligieri.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
We're both asked the same.
Okay.
Neither of them could confirm that there were actual language saying about camps or reprisals.
Just
whatever language that was frightening,
mm-hmm.
Ehrenburg and Javier and Aligier and all of them,
mm-hmm.
must have been phrased in a much more vague, indeterminate way. But everyone in that generation is convinced, and I interviewed Ehrenberg's daughter numerous times,
mm-hmm.
they were convinced that that was Stalin's intention, and that the letters reflected that intention.
And it was also contextually understood by the people who...
Subsequently, more softer letters were produced that...
Right.
That nothing was published.
Okay, thank you.
Wonderful. Great. Well, please join me in thanking our speakers, Alexandra Popoff and Boris Lanin.
Thank you.
And also please join us in the spring for two events in this series. And thanks so much for being here.